بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful to all of our viewers out there. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon all of us. And thank you for joining us in the rationale, the intersection of faith and reason with our beloved guest here, Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Dr. Ja'far, it's good to be with you again, sir. And it's been such a pleasure in the past few episodes, truly being a joy, and we look forward for more of this inshallah. Last time we spoke about freedom and the different types of freedom, and now we would like to move to another topic, if we may please, inshallah, and that is a common misconception that some of our non-Muslim brothers and sisters have, that is about Islam's view of them, whoever them or the others may be. So this will be our topic for this episode, and the Islamic view, what does Islam say about non-Muslims or people who do not adhere to the teachings and the practice and the beliefs of Islam and Muslims?
Yes, what you have just said defines what we mean by the other. In this context, of course, the other can have so many other meanings, but we are, I think you are thinking of the other in terms of people who are not Muslims, who are not Muslims. What is our position regarding them? And I have always thought, when I read the Quran and think about other ideologies and religions, my conclusion, I might be wrong, my conclusion is that no religion at all or ideology, even secular ideologies, compares with Islam in its comprehensive enumeration of the categories of people who are not Muslims and of the right or an appropriate position that should be taken regarding them.
Sheikh, that's a big statement, I think. But how about just make sure that we defend that statement, if we may, please.
Now, there is nothing in Judaism or Christianity about Islam in the present scriptures.
Sure. No,
there is nothing. Of course, we know that in the early original scriptures, there was something about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, for a religious person who is Christian or who is Jewish, there is nothing in the scriptures which she reads about this other religion.
Specifically about Islam. We may be under a bigger group such as Gentiles or non-Christians or what have you, but not specifically.
No. And nothing also about, if he is Jew, he finds nothing about Christianity and so on. In Islam, there's a detailed enumeration of these non-Islamic religions and groups. For example, you find something about Jews, something about Christians, something about Magians, idol worshippers, people who are atheists, and so on. Also, something very interesting about Islam is that I don't think that there is any other ideology except the secular ones which confess or state this, that not all people will be Muslims. Not all people will be Muslims. And therefore, it cannot say that all non-Muslims must be killed, because this means that most people should be killed. In Marxism, for example, they used to believe, according to the ideology, that this is the ideology of the future, and that it will spread all over the world, and it will be accepted, and so on. So there is no room for the other. The other is moving against what they call against history, and therefore he has to be removed
Even if that elimination is a peaceful elimination, but the other ultimately, according to this ideology, will not exist.
Will not exist, because he is moving against the march of history. Mm-hmm. This is how history. The same idea was expressed by Fukuyama. Mm-hmm. And of course, he changed his mind later on.
And Fukuyama is the author of the...
The famous book...
Clash of Civilizations.
No.
I'm sorry.
Fukuyama... what is it called? The end... I forgot the name. Inshallah, I will remember. The end of... I forgot the name. So in that book, he said... democracy and capitalism are the end of history. His book is The End of History. That the West has reached the end of history, mm-hmm. as far as the economic theories and political theories are concerned. And all the world will be moving towards this end now. And this is what he meant by the end of history. He doesn't mean that there will be no history. There will be history, but all people are moving towards this. And he said people all over the world now think so, except Muslims. And I appreciated that, but he made an exception. So if you think that this is the end of history and that this is the natural thing for all people to do, and they are going to do, then you will not tolerate those who
oppose.
Who oppose. So this is one reason. Or one advantage of Islam over other religions and ideologies as far as its position regarding the other is concerned.
Meaning that it acknowledges that there will always be the other.
In fact, it says something that no ideology, other ideology would say. It says that ultimately the number of Muslims will be small, and all of them will die before the end of time. Hmm. Only people will revert, go back to worshipping idols, even in Mecca. They will revive those old idols. And this is, in my opinion, is one evidence that this religion must be from God. Because no human being would advocate a religion and they say something like this about it. Because he will think that if he says this, then people, why should one accept a religion that like
will eventually
this?
No. Fade out.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But because it is from God, it tells you the truth. Whether you like it or not, this is what is going to happen. Mm-hmm. Now. Mm-hmm. And also it means... that you should not make your choice according to the position of other people, even if they be the majority. Mm-hmm. You should opt for the truth, irrespective of the position of other people regarding this truth.
One of my favorite quotes that go along these lines is when somebody said, right is right even if no one is doing it, and wrong is wrong, even if everybody is doing it.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal to be right when everybody else is right. It's a big deal to be right when everybody else is wrong. So majority is not to be taken.
If he said a majority, that would have been better, but not everyone. Not everyone would be wrong. So
these are the some of the advantages that you said that Islam has over other religions or ideologies.
No.
And from there on, Sheikh, then what does Islam say about, we learn now that it acknowledges that they will always be there.
No.
Therefore,
what
happens to them?
There are general principles that apply to all the others. Huh? general. Let us concentrate on this. We don't want to go into the details of how to treat Jews, how to treat Christians, how to and so on. Just the general principles might be enough for this interview. The first thing that Islam says, that your first duty towards these people is to invite them to the truth. This is the most noble task that a person can do. And this, because of this, God chose the best people, the best people to convey this message to other people. The main task of prophets is to invite people to Islam.
And that's what you meant by the best people.
The best people, the prophets, I mean. Mm-hmm. And therefore, it is the duty of every believer to follow in the footsteps of the prophets and concern himself with inviting people to the truth. Mm-hmm. So this is our main position towards, this is the main thing. Mm-hmm. Now, what do we do our position will depend on the response to this invitation. Mm-hmm. Won't it? If they accept our invitation, then they become Muslims in the full sense of the word, irrespective of their earlier positions, irrespective of their race, or irrespective of the even criminal acts that they committed, and so on. They become Muslims, full-fledged Muslims.
Immediately.
And they become part of the Muslim community. There are verses in the Quran which says this, like this verse that I have here. The verse which says, it talks, let us not read the whole verse. It's a verse in Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verses 9 to 11. It talks about people who broke their promises with Muslims, who did not keep who treated Muslims and so on. But then it says, if they accept the truth and pray and pay the poor zakah, then they become your brothers. So this is the first thing. This will be our position regarding
these people,
the people who accept the truth.
When we come back, our invitation to them implies that somewhat what it is that they believe in, regardless of what it is that Islam does not see as the most proper of ways. That is implied there. So this will be my question to you when we come back from our break. So please do stay tuned with us, and we shall return, inshallah, soon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, and welcome back again to The Rationale, the intersection of faith and reason, with our guest here, Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Dr. Ja'far, we're talking about one of the noblest things that Muslims are asked to do for the others, regardless of who they are, is to invite them to the way of Islam, and this will be following the footsteps of the messenger. In that case, isn't it, though, implied that Islam does not necessarily recognize the beliefs or the ways of the others? Isn't that implied there?
Of course. It is, that is why they are inviting them to the truth. They might have part of this truth, half of this truth or so, but now they are invited to the complete truth regarding their belief in the Creator. So yes, it is. Otherwise, there will be no reason why invite them. Because if you believe that they are like you, as some people now would say, that you have to tolerate other people, respect them in the sense of saying that they are like me. Of course, if they are like me, then there is no reason for inviting them to the truth. Mm-hmm. but you believe that you are doing them a great service by inviting them to the truth, because you are not inviting them just to increase the number of Muslims or to use them for some worldly ends or so. You are inviting them to the truth because you believe that this will make them very happy in this world and in the world to come. This is what they should do as human beings. So your motive should be a very noble motive. You don't invite them just to make you stronger, because you don't need this.
No. Sheikh, you're also using words like invite, as if you are extending an invitation, and then at that point it is up to them whether they accept it or not.
Yes, because this is true. Because we gave the example of our position regarding those who accept. Now, suppose that someone said, I don't accept.
I like what I am.
I am. And this can be of two kinds. Someone who says, I don't accept what you say, but I want to live in peace with you. I have no intention of fighting you or so. Then to this person, we say, لا إكراه في الدين. There is no compulsion in religion. And we accept you even as a member of our community and want you to live in peace with us.
So an invitation, but no compulsion.
No compulsion, no. And no compulsion, many people think that this is the only verse in the Quran which expresses this fact. But in fact, it is one of many verses.
You're talking about La Ikraha
La Ikraha fi Deen. There is no compulsion in religion. Mm-hmm. Because there is a fact that is emphasized in so many verses in the Quran that no prophet, no human being has the power to instill faith in any person's heart. Mm-hmm. And faith is something that is in the heart. Mm-hmm. So it cannot be forced on anyone. Mm-hmm. And if you can force someone to say, I'm a Muslim, but this is not what you want. Mm-hmm. What you want is to make him a real Muslim. And you cannot instill this faith in him. So you say there is no compulsion in religion. And I have just said that this is expressed in so many other verses in the Quran, like telling the Prophet in many verses, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتُ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You don't guide whom you love to guide, but this is Allah, God, who guides people. And God guides them according to what He knows about what is going on in their hearts. If a person's intention is to know the truth, then God will help him to see the truth and to accept it. If he knows that he is adamant on not changing his mind and he doesn't speak about the truth, or so he just wants to continue doing what he is doing, then that is not the kind of person that God will help.
But at least the invitation was extended to that person. Sheikh, if I remember correctly, the verse that you just quoted, La Ikraha fi Deen, the event or the circumstances during which it was revealed, I believe these were parents that actually came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, consulting him about their children who have refused to accept Islam, and they said, can we force them to accept Islam? And then this verse was revealed that there should be no compulsion in religion.
And no compulsion in religion for the reason that you have just made. Because according to some of the interpreters of the Quran, I think it was Ibn Kathir, some took this to be a statement of fact, not just a prohibition. Hmm. It doesn't say, don't force them. It says there can be no compulsion in religion. Mm-hmm. So don't try the impossible. Because the task, the duty of the Prophet is not, as I said, to instill faith in the people. So he can't do this. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرْ. You are only a reminder. You have no control over them. And therefore, if they don't accept your invitation, you are not to be blamed, because you have done what
you are asked to do.
You are not, and many of our brothers forget this. They get very upset also when people don't listen to them, and they want everyone in the world to become a Muslim just because they tell them to be so. No, God gave to human beings the choice.
And people have the right to practice that choice, whichever way they want. Yeah. So that is, I'm sorry if we're spending a little more time on this topic, but due to the huge misconception that is out there, that Muslims are out there to either convert people to their religion or to eliminate them if they do not accept that.
Yes, I know.
And even though you're saying that is not the case, these are not the teachings of the Quran.
Now, we said that it depends on the
reaction
reaction of those who don't accept. Either, as we said before, they say, okay, we don't accept, but we want to live in peace with you. We say, okay. Now, what about those who say, we don't accept, we think that what you are doing is something harmful, and we will fight you. Now, here, the Quran says, fight them. Fight them. And there is a verse in the Quran. In fact, there are verses about the first position that you are aware of, that لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم. God does not forbid you regarding those who
neither persecuted you.
No, they don't fight you and so on, to be good to them. إنما ينهاكم الله عن الذين قاتلوكم في الدين. Allah forbids you regarding, but Allah forbids you regarding those
who fight you,
who fought you, and who helped those who fought you, and so on. That don't take them as allies or friends. These, and in another verse, it says, قاتلوا الذين يقاتلونكم. Fight those who fight you. ولا تعتدوا. And don't be the aggressors, because God does not love the aggressors.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ.
So this is the position regarding those who refuse to accept the truth, but who also go on and decide to fight the Muslims. They must be fought. So Islam is a peaceful religion, but it is not a pacifist religion. It does not say, even if they fight us, we don't care. No, the truth has to be defended when there is aggression against the truth. It has to be defended and fought and fought on its behalf.
So you're saying that the Quran classifies people into two categories.
Yes.
Accept but want to live in peace.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There's three categories. The first one is
to accept.
Accept and be one of you.
Right. Mm. And you said be one of you immediately.
Yes.
أقاموا الصلاة,
آتوا
الزكاة, فإخوانكم في الدين.
Yes.
Establish prayers, they pay their due to the poor, and they immediately become your brethren.
Yes.
And then choose to refuse, but also remain peaceful.
Yes.
And to these Allah said, deal with them with birr, goodness, and qist, which is just or equity. And then you said, in the case of those who refuse and choose to be hostile, Allah said, you fight back.
Yes.
And you said that Islam is not a pacifist religion that sense.
Yes. And this is not as some non-Muslims now say. This is not something just in the book. Islamic history proves this. I don't know whether you read this reply of this Israeli intellectual, his reply to the Pope mm-hmm. about the statement he made.
Mm-hmm.
And he said something very interesting. He seems to be, and he's an essayist. He said, I am an essayist. But I know that when the Jews were expelled from Spain, they went to the Muslim world.
Mm-hmm.
And he enumerated the countries to which they went. Some of them came to the Sudan. So he said that these people, why did the Jews choose to come to the Muslim world? Because they knew that so long as they live in peace, they will be tolerated by Muslims. And you know, for example, in Egypt, there are the Copts. In the Sudan, there are Copts and other people of other Christian denomination. There were some Jews. So even our history proves that we have been tolerant to these people. And this is because of these verses
that
of
are
the Quran. And he said something very interesting also. He said that every Jew who knows the history of his people should be grateful to Islam, because it was Islam that allowed the Jews, I think he said for 4 or 5 centuries, to live in peace. Had it not been for Islam, they would have been exterminated.
The Jewish community,
yes,
in Christian Europe. Sheikh, I do believe that this topic needs to be visited again,
okay.
And we do have more questions with regard to this issue. But believe it or not, our time is really up, and we're glad that you were joining us for this part of our program. Thank you for doing so, and we would hope that you would join us next time as well. Until then, we say so long, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.